Chapter 19, Frankfurt, March 22, 1945. In Frankfurt, the Nazi flag still flew defiantly outside the sandbagged building which housed the city's Gestapo headquarters. This street, like most of the others in the ancient city centre, had been recently and relentlessly bombed by the Allied onslaught. I found myself alternately cursing and cheering the waves of American and British bombers. They took it in turns. The Americans were over us in the daylight hours and the British at night. Seemingly never-ending waves of heavy aircraft droned over our country, dropping their immense loads of destruction down on us. I had heard about what happened to my hometown in September of 44. They had literally wiped Darmstadt off the face of the map. My town, once inhabited by over 100,000 people, had been decimated. I'd seen pictures of the almost unbelievable catastrophe, but it was hard to reconcile those images with the beautiful ancient place in which I'd grown up. But now, such overwhelming, almost apocalyptic carnage was commonplace in Germany. We were being systematically brought to our knees. The stench and mess of the bombs and the resulting horrific bloodbath was everywhere. Rubble was being cleared this morning like every other recent day. This revealed the grisly crop of the freshly dead and maimed. It was hard to believe that the mounds of smashed bricks were once proud buildings that had stood for so long. There was an air of lethargy and defeat permeating every fibre of the worn-out rescue parties as they sought to find life amongst death. A very young blonde boy drove me to the headquarters. He didn't look more than 16, and he was wearing an ill-fitting brown suit. The once mighty Nazi machine was really reaching far down in the barrel. If they were enlisting babies like this one. As we pulled up outside the once grand building, the boy opened the door for me politely enough. I had become middle-aged without noticing. I realized as I saw my reflection in the car window when I got out. Perhaps stress had accelerated my aging. I straightened up, glad that my suit was still the finest cut and style. At least I could maintain those things I could control. I was ushered past the guards into the building and up a huge sweeping staircase to the familiar and magnificent set of double doors. We entered, and I was whisked past the busy office staff straight to Rattweller's office. He stood and personally pulled a chair back for me, opposite his own, across his vast desk. He sent the boy out and asked how I was. "What do you want?" I asked. He made a tutting sound and shook his head. "No one is all bad," he admonished me. "The way you seem to think I am. I could be so insulted. But of course you're right about one thing. I did ask you to visit me for more than social purpose." "Get on with it, Rattweller," I growled. "Perhaps the problem is that we're just too familiar with one another. You know the saying, familiarity breeds contempt. All these years we've been friends, sharing so much in every regard. We should be the very best of friends, almost like brothers, yes?" I waited, knowing that he would soon get tired of his baiting. "For example, here I am seeking your advice, your guidance, your succour." Nervous that the Russians might get here before the British or the Americans, in that case, I would recommend you follow the cyanide option for yourself. Save everyone the trouble of a trial. "Do you think that they'll be particularly bothered by me? A petty bureaucrat? I haven't been so bad. Not when compared to some of my colleagues. My position was often misconstrued and misunderstood. I was just following orders, like all soldiers must. My heart was always with the movement. You'll recall how you and your associates were repeatedly allowed to carry on your noble resistance thanks to my personal intercession." I smiled. "And the fact that you were creaming off so much money from me, I'm sure that the Russians will be most understanding and sympathetic to all this rubbish. Are you rehearsing this for me? How charming. No, I think perhaps it's time I went on a nice long vacation. I've not been allowed the luxury of a holiday in so long. Everyone needs a break, don't you think? You didn't get me here to recommend a hotel, did you? If the rats are going to scurry away, just go into the nearest sewer where you belong. Arnie, you really don't like me very much, do you? Despite the fact that with my protection you've become one of the wealthiest men in the city. What is it? Have you spent all the money you stole from me? I will gladly give you a bit more if it guaranteed you would vanish forever. Such hate, he hissed. Can't we be friends now it's nearly all over? I prefer being your enemy. I looked into his eyes, and as usual, the dark pools gave nothing away. We need each other even now, Arnie. We need each other. I made it possible for your genius to flourish, to leave questions unasked, questions that would have led, could still do, to a firing squad. You don't get it, do you? I knew that with you, I was always at a big disadvantage. You might not have the use of your arms, but you do have talent. Look at how you can paint and draw. Me? All I can do is destroy and pull things down. I knew from when we were boys that my only real talent was to recognize the gifts of others and to capitalize on them. We are inseparable. I think the correct word is conjoined. Two bodies feeding on one heart, and that heart would be yours. Are you really going to wait here to test your theories in front of a Soviet firing squad? I don't think so. Ratweller smiled mirthlessly. We still need each other. I have to get out of Germany, and you will assist me. Why should I? Our paths have cancelled each other out. His smile grew wider. I'm like a magician. Remember that. I always have something up my sleeve. For this trick, to get me to help you when I'm enjoying watching you squirm, I don't think you've anything left. Okay, let's try this one on for size. I know where your friend Helmut is. Do you? He's at our headquarters. But I could see that my information was out of date. Not anymore, he told me. He's now at one of those awful camps. You know what they're like. Not very nice. Not too many people use the exit door. You've put Helmut into an extermination camp. Is he all right? I will go straight to the Führer himself about this. You forget I had the ultimate ace up my sleeve. Ratweller pulled open the central drawer of his desk and held up a piece of paper and examined it. No, you won't. And you'll read this note. He placed the paper in front of me on the desk. So you forced a confession out of him. Hitler knows what such confessions are worth. Do you think he'll believe this shit? Well, it was the best I could do at short notice, and you must admit, it's very plausible. You sound like a very naughty boy taking advantage of the Führer's kindness. And it doesn't mention me once. Did you notice that? What will happen to Helmut? If we cooperate, then nothing will happen to Heine. Nothing at all. And if I don't? Well, you won't have long to find out. I think he'll be having one of the camp's special showers in... He looks at his watch. 1 hour, give or take a few minutes. And for sure I can arrange some nasty little car accident for you just to make it a perfect day. Who knows what would happen to those charming little fellows of yours in that situation? I suppose they would be taken into care. It's as I told you, we really do need each other. Is it for pleasure that you do this to me? You don't need me anymore. You've got more money than you could spend, I'm sure you must have prepared your escape route long ago, organized with your pals in the SS. I'm a businessman, remember, he sighed. Haven't I proved that in our partnership? You will go on earning for me long after this nasty war is finished. Besides which, you're a much better ally for me than the SS. You have credibility with both Hitler and the movement. That's a win-win. I tried not to allow a flicker of emotion to show on my face, now that Ratwiller had revealed that he knew I was with the resistance. But I had to know what he knew, even at the cost of my own security. How did you know? Does it matter? I know, he replied, not bothering to conceal the triumphant look that surfaced on his face. Okay, we still need each other. What now? It's time to leave Germany, he answered. Okay, I said, but now, at the risk of everything, I have some conditions of my own. If we do this, that's it. No more money, no contact, we're finished with each other. Forever. Agreed? Yes, he said, we have a deal. As he said these words, there was the sound of rolling thunder above us, and the birdsong seemed to stop as the shrill siren sounded. The world held its breath, and hell visited Frankfurt. The building exploded around us, and as the room blew apart, Ratwiller jumped over the desk to protect me from the mayhem. The next moments were chaos, compounded by terror, screams and deafness. I didn't realize that I was one of those screaming as we plummeted downwards with the building as it evaporated around us. When I regained consciousness, I found myself trapped under Ratwiller and a mountain of rubble. I tried shifting my body away, but he was wedged on top of me. I suddenly remembered that Helmut's existence would depend on my waking Ratwiller, if he was still alive, and getting him to find a telephone that was working, or Helmut would be murdered like so many others. Help! Help! We're trapped! I screamed at the top of my lungs. Before I understood that I couldn't hear myself, my eardrums were ringing but useless. No one came, but I felt Ratwiller stir groggily. Wake up, you bastard, I shouted into his ear. But I didn't know if he could hear me, or whether there was any sound coming from my mouth. Ratwiller, you little bastard, wake up, I shouted, and at last he began to respond. He opened his eyes, and we were staring at each other, inches apart. Now we were really conjoined, I thought, unable to separate by even 1 centimeter. What happened? He croaked. And I could hear him a little. We were hit by a bomb, I replied. Don't shout, I'm right here on top of you. I hadn't realized that I was shouting. He tried to move off me, but something was trapping him on top of me. I often thought what it would be like to be intimate with you, Arnie, but this is not what I imagined. We both grimaced at each other. Can't you at least slide off me? Your weight's crushing me, I said. What do you think, I'm enjoying this? I've half a building on my back and I'm protecting you from it, and you're complaining. We lay there, with acrid smells of dust choking us for what seemed like an age, but in truth wasn't very long. However we tried to shift ourselves, we were pinned helplessly to the ground. Ratwiller began to breathe erratically. Do you think anyone knows we're here? He sounded panicky. Of course they do. And the one thing about you Nazis, the record-keeping is meticulous. When we get out, what are you going to do with Marlene? I asked. So do you care? Of course. What do I care? You can have her back. I'm finished with her now. Not long after this, we both heard the scrambling noise of the search and rescue teams. Hello, we're here, I shouted, and within another few moments, we were being dug out of the tomb. If you don't get Helmut out of that camp in time, all bets are off, I hissed in his ear, just before we were pulled out. Don't worry, he said. He's been downstairs in a cell all along. As always with Ratweller, I wasn't quite quick enough to find out the truth before he was gone, vanishing in the confusion and mayhem that surrounded the day's bombing. Over 1,000 people had died in those few minutes, but I didn't know where to begin to look for my friends. The only person I knew who might help me was still living in one of the finest addresses in town. The roads were all but impassable, cratered by the huge bombs, but nothing was going to stop me finding that house. Eventually, I found my way to the house I remembered from my childhood. Once it belonged to my grandparents, but now it belonged to Ratweller. It was untouched by all the devastation around it. As I staggered up the stairs to the front door, it was opened, and there stood Marlene. She saw the disheveled state I was in and brought me inside. As she cleansed my wounds with the easy familiarity of past intimacies, she let me come to my senses in my own time. Initially, I didn't know what to say, but it felt wonderful and cathartic for her gentle hands to wash my wounds. "How are the boys?" she asked. Eventually, incongruously, I answered with extreme formality. "My sons are well, thank you." She finished her ministrations and stood back from me. Our shared intimacy was over. "Why did you come here?" she asked me. "I don't know." And that was the first honest words from me to Marlene for as long as I could remember. We were married, we loved each other, there was too much left unsaid. We never finished properly. We need to tie up everything. It was no way to end our marriage. She looked into my eyes. "You're right. But you knew what it was about. We did what was necessary. Will you help me this time? The movement has had enough of us, don't you think?" Without a moment's hesitation, she nodded her head. "Of course. What do you want?" "Just like that? No conditions?" I asked. "I'm not Mr. Ratweller. You want my help now or ever in the future? You have it. Let me tell you what it is first. You might not be so quick to be so generous. I gave myself body and soul for our country. You deserve whatever is left." At that moment, I wished I could wind back time to what might have been had our lives not been contaminated by this poisonous war. Now we were two sad people looking to each other for comfort and memories. "Do you remember when our lives were simple? Eating, breathing, and making love?" I said. "Yes," she whispered wistfully. "Maybe one day it can be like that again." On saying this, she reached across the distance between us, with her hand caressing my neck. I'm not ashamed to admit that I wept for us. "I'm sorry, Marlene, but I don't think I'm mature enough to deal with the thought of you with him. Whatever the motive, I can't deal with it." She looked at me as if I was a silly boy, and she was a woman, full-grown, mature, and pitying my inadequacy, despite her love and warmth. "What do you want me to do?" she asked, anxious to change the subject. "Get my sons to my mother." Marlene was surprised by this. "To Palestine? Why?" "There they can grow up as Jews. They can be themselves. But their mother wasn't Jewish. Or their grandfather. Hitler made them Jewish. Will you do this for me, Marlene?" "You know the answer, Arnie. Your boys will be safe with me." I smiled, knowing that this was the truth. Hours later, I was with Ratweller, who was driving us in his open-topped car fast down deserted country roads. He was dressed in full uniform. I watched the world as we sped past. It was as if the war had forgotten this corner of Germany. It was totally untouched. I looked at the rat and wondered what twisted logic motivated him. He was singing a Wagnerian aria from the Ring Cycle, apparently happy with a glorious winter day. "How do you sleep at night?" I asked him. He briefly looked away from the road. "Like a baby. I sleep the sleep of the just. Your problem, Arnie, and it was always thus, is that you simply don't understand the ways of the world. The ways of your world, I don't want to understand. Whatever system there is in control of our lives, and there will always be a system in control, the systems always need functionaries, like me. We make it all go tick-tock, tick-tock. I do the smelly jobs, and we do them without question, because someone has to take the shit out. I'm necessary, more necessary than some painter or poet. You believe that? I asked. Of course I believe that. Don't get me wrong, I was never a Nazi. Not really. Oh, of course, they did some things, right as history will prove, but some of their ideas were plain stupid. But I had a great war, and I have a lot to be grateful to them for. But I will serve the communists or the Allies just as well. Make no mistake, they all have their little rat-dwellers just like me. Before I could respond to his cynicism, he swerved the car off the centre of the road as bullets tore into the car's windscreen, and looked up as we crashed into the bushes and trees and caught a swift glimpse of a lone British Spitfire fighter plane as it swept past our position and banked steeply, preparing to attack us again. As we smashed into the trees, I could see that Ratweller had been wounded in the arm and was unable to steer. I sat helplessly as we hit the trees, and although I braced myself with both my legs, there was nothing I could do as the rat's head and shoulders smashed through the car windscreen. The doors of the car were forced open as we hit a huge tree, and seeing this opportunity for escape, I leapt from the car. As I lay on my back looking up and panting from the effort, I saw through the canopy of trees as the RAF plane completed its turn and came in for the kill. I braced myself to die, convinced that this was it, my time to die. I saw Ratweller stir, and instinctively I jumped to my feet and back into the car. Now I was operating on adrenaline. As I raced against the aircraft, as it swooped towards us, I tried to brace my back against the leather seat and use my legs to kick Ratweller sideways from the car. Somehow his body began to slide half out of the car, but it was so difficult. I looked up and the fighter plane seemed to fill the sky above me. I could see the pilot's face as he pressed the firing button of his guns. And the bullets tore into the car, tracing their way up the bonnet of the car just as Ratweller's body fell from his side of the car and I jerked in the opposite direction from it. The bullets tore the car apart, but I hadn't been hit. The Spitfire flew away, its engine noise reducing as it departed. Ratweller was standing and shaking his fist. "British bastards!" he screamed. And then, realizing the danger we were still in, he rushed around the car and dragged me away as its petrol tank exploded in a ball of flame. For a long while, we lay exhausted on the ground, unable to get up. We looked at each other, and I wondered why we were still like cats. Why did fate want the two of us to live? Later, the wreckage smoldered, but the flames had burnt out. An American Army Jeep screeched to a halt. The two soldiers in it got out of their vehicle, pointing their weapons in our direction, suspicious of the circumstances. "Help me, please, I'm trapped over here," I called in my best English. The older man, an officer, approached me slowly. He looked like he would have been happier driving a taxi in New York. "Bill," he called to his colleague, "check the Nazi bastard out. Any funny stuff and you shoot his head off. Shoot first, answer questions later. Got it?" I lay very still and hoped for the best. Bill called back to his officer, "Can't we shoot the bastards anyhow and no one will ever know the difference?" The officer ignored Bill and moved closer to the inert body of Ratweller. He nudged him with his boot, and Ratweller grunted in agony. Meanwhile, Bill knelt by me. "You look okay, kind of, but I think I'd best shoot you anyhow." "What did I do to you?" I asked him. "Let's show the bastard," the officer shouted back. He dragged Rottweiler to his feet, and I was roughly manhandled and handcuffed, my wrist to the rat, despite my trying to explain that I couldn't use my arms. We were shoved into their jeep, and we rapidly drove off. The vehicle forced its way through an ever-increasing flood of hapless and ragged refugees. Signs of a recent bloody battle were all about us. Burnt-out tanks and half-tracks and unattended German corpses littered the roads. "Will you let me explain? I am not a Nazi," I tried again to tell the officer. "Sure you're not. You're just out joyriding with your Gestapo pal here." Rottweiler smiled. "I told you, Arnie, every system has their own Rottweiler, and you can keep your smart mouth shut," said the officer to Rottweiler. We were silent in the jeep as we drove into a camp. It seemed innocuous enough, and the only thing that struck me as strange was the wording of the slogan set above the gates. "Work will set you free." We drove past two American guards. Large bonfires lit the area, casting weird shadows. It was then that we began to see and understand where we were. Emaciated men, women, and children sat in small groups. They are skeletal. Their eyes appeared huge in contrast to their sunken faces. Behind them, in a huge pile, we could see something. At first, we thought it might be piles of wood or discarded clothing, but as our eyes adjusted to the gloom, we understood that these were thousands of unburied human bodies. We had entered a shadow world that I had dreaded, had partially imagined in my worst nightmares, but couldn't believe was possible. Nothing could prepare a human being for the shocking totality of this. Medical orderlies were spraying disinfectant over the living and the dead with spray guns. Their masked faces lent an almost science fiction feeling to the scene. The officer turned to us. "Give me one good reason why we shouldn't shoot you Nazi bastards here and now." Rottweiler turned to face him. "Because you are a civilized man," he replied. Bill raised his gun and aimed it at Rottweiler, who winced as he thought his life might finally end. "You can't want to be like the people who did this," I said to him. The American officer forced Bill's gun arm down to the ground. He seemed to realize that I wasn't like the Nazi he had encountered up to then. "Undo that one's handcuffs," he instructed, which Bill then did. "What's wrong with your arms?" the officer asked. "Why do you ask?" "Because a normal person rubs his wrists when we take the cuffs off. Everyone does that." "I haven't been able to use my arm since I was 7 years old." "Polio." The officer was baffled. He looked at me thoughtfully. "Why didn't you say something?" "Would you have believed anything I said?" "No, I guess not. I wasn't in the mood to listen." "Come on, follow me," he said to me, and then led me away from the horrific backdrop. "What about me?" called Rottweiler. "I'm bleeding to death." The officer looked back over his shoulder at Rottweiler. "Good." I followed the man into a large, prefabricated hut that the Americans had erected inside the camp. It was clean and full of the best American supplies. In fact, it was like being in an American microcosm. Everything had been shipped from the USA. We sat on two stools with our backs resting on the bar. The windows were blacked out by closed shades, and the walls decorated with posters and pictures depicting American scenes. The officer was soon swigging beer from the bottle and occasionally held another bottle for me to do the same. He gestured to the room and the other men who were also taking some time out to have a drink. "This keeps us sane. This little bit of home." "It's very nice," I commented. "My name is Hank Arneson. Henry, really, but you can call me Hank." "You come from New York, Hank?" He took another long pull from his bottle and gave me one from the other bottle. "Near enough, Arnie. Philadelphia." How about you? Where are you from? Darmstadt. It was a little city, but now it's gone. Do you think you are going to let me go, Hank? I really was one of the good guys. He sighed and looked at me intently, as if studying my face would give him some answers. You know what my job is going to be? I'm a combat marine. But now they have me sorting through this place to find out who were the Nazis and who were the good guys. Someone has to run things in the future. Maybe someone like you could help me. Maybe I could get a handle on how this all happened. You're in intelligence. Well, kind of. But you've got nothing to worry about from me, have you? I need to talk with you. Folks like you, anyhow. How could this have happened? You people seem like regular folks back home. You seem normal, a stand-up guy. Tell me, did you all just go crazy one day? No, I shook my head. It happens inch by inch. The madmen take over a place and turn it into an asylum where they, the mad people, are in charge. Once you believe that black is white and white is black, then anything begins to seem the wrong way round. It's their big lies. Once the big lies become an accepted fact, then everything follows that madness. It's as if the country was a tree, and the tree was poisoned, and then all the fruit that comes from that tree will also be poisoned. He looked at me thoughtfully. What's your story? How did you end up sharing a car with that piece of garbage? Is this an interrogation, Hank? He smiled, and he shook his head. More like some friendly questions and answers. I can't help it. I was an attorney before this war interrupted my career. Now take another swig of this excellent beer and answer my questions. I did as he suggested. The beer was cold, and although not to my normal taste, it was fine. It's a very long story, I began. We've got nothing but time, he encouraged me. A long time, and a great many beers later, we were still talking. But we were now both loosened up by the booze. One thing is for sure, Arnie. No, two things, he slurred his words slightly. One is that if you're a woman, it's really not a great idea to get too close to you. It is dangerous, no question. And two is you need legal representation. Did I give you my card? I don't need a lawyer right now, was all I could think of to say. He smiled and continued. If you're thinking of doing any business in the United States, you need a lawyer or you'll be skinned alive. Why? I don't need one here unless there's a special contract. He looked at me with pity. Bubala, you're going to have to register as a charity. No tax. That way, what a wonderful scam. A business for the handicapped, run by the handicapped, for the benefit of the handicapped. It's beautiful. You're going to need headquarters, staffing, expanded funding, political connections. They've got to be vetted, and you've got to be protected. Who from? I asked, with a growing sense of exasperation. From people like me, you idiot! I could only smile at his honesty, about his potential dishonesty. You're playing games with me. Sure I am. It beats us thinking about that mess outside, don't you think? With that, he walked to the door of the hut, somewhat erratically. I only drunk this much since I got here, you know. Before I was here, it was coffee and a cigarette. Now, I don't sleep so good. You know what I mean? I nodded my head. I understood. I wouldn't be able to sleep with those images burnt behind my eyes. We were both compelled to leave the warmth of the hut to witness the reality of our surroundings. This nightmare, what the Nazi inheritance was going to mean to us all. This was a vision of hell on earth. We walked past people too weak to stand, too scared to sit in case they would simply die unnoticed. Steam seemed to seep from the ground, and through these living skeletons. They looked at us with their huge eyes, and we shared the intimate knowledge that they were nearer to their Maker than the world we were standing in. I was too numb to cry for them, and too inadequate to do anything other than register what I was seeing, so that I could paint it later. It was a part of me that I hated. This divorcing of me from my surroundings in order that I could regurgitate the scenes I witnessed to order, even re-inhabiting the moment. This meant I was sometimes present, but not there emotionally. Women especially hated this part of me, which I could do nothing about. Hank led me to another American temporary building. We entered. A young soldier was asleep at his desk. The room is plainly some kind of records office. Papers and files are strewn everywhere. Some of the papers are partially burned. Hank spoke to me quietly, anxious not to wake the soldier. You people kept real fine, methodical records, didn't you? Seems that some of the high-ups weren't so proud and tried to burn them. But a bit too late, we stopped them just before they made a big bonfire of the whole bunch. Why did you bring me here? I believe your story. I think maybe you'll find something that leads you to your pal Helmet in here. It's worth a shot. I looked at him with new regard and respect. Maybe I should have one of those business cards of yours. He smiled and placed a card in my jacket pocket. Sure you do. Everyone needs a mouthpiece. We looked at each other and both of us knew a new friendship had just been struck. Hank went behind the young sleeping soldier and shouted in his ear, "Wake up, soldier! You've got work to do!" The soldier woke comically, almost falling out of his seat with surprise. He sprung to attention and knocked his chair over. While I was engaged looking at endless books of photos, Ratweller was seizing the opportunity that fate presented him with. I wasn't aware of it, but he was making sure that our fates would continue to be interwoven. Several hours later, I was as weary as the young soldier. We'd been working together for hours before I decided to leave after finding no leads. Hank entered the hut and asked me if I'd made any progress. I shook my head. So many photographs, so many faces, gone. All of them gone. All of them dead. Yes. He was quiet a moment, thinking about those huge files of lost people. Anyone whose record is in that hut is past tense, so if your pal was here and not listed amongst those people, he could still be alive. How many of these places were there? We're still finding them all over this part of Europe, too many to count. Are you going to keep looking for your pal? What would you do? Same as you, I'd look until I couldn't look no more. That makes us two dumb schmucks. You're ready for some more bad news? I wasn't sure I was, but what could be worse than this place? Tell me, I said. Your friend Ratweller has escaped. He must have got out somehow. Security thinks he must have dressed as an inmate after stealing clothes and possibly the identity from a dead man. That would be typical of him. What are you going to do about it? I asked, nonplussed by this turn of events. What we call a snafu. Situation normal, all fucked up. What can I tell you? You know that's how comes you win wars? You fuck up just a little less than the other guy, and you win. Don't you realize what a dangerous little bastard he is? You have to send men after him. What do you want me to do, stick a broom up my ass so I can sweep the floor as I'm looking? We're chasing a nation of dangerous little men. He ain't any worse than a whole pile of the bastards, believe me. I couldn't maintain my anger with him. I found myself smiling and realized that Ratweller would have to wait for another day. At least there is one upside to all this. That creep, Ratty, or whatever his name is, he won't dare show his face around here again, and that means he won't bother anyone around here again. I hope you're right, Hank. Can you do me one more favor? Sure thing, name it, he said. I want to go home. It wasn't long. Hank, good as his word, had arranged for the American military machine to crank up and transport me back to my home. As the Jeep dropped me by the front door of our old Darmstadt Hessel family home, I could see it was still shuttered and appeared to be in one piece, if sadly neglected. It looked forlorn somehow. The driver took the key from under the ornate flower pot to the left of the front doors, where we'd left it, and opened the house. He stood aside, as if it would be inappropriate for him to enter my home before me. He stood awkwardly to one side as I entered. I smiled in his direction. It's all right, you don't have to worry about me, I can look after myself, I assured him, and hoped it was true as he said goodbye and left me alone with my memories. After a while, it wasn't so bad. I had been able to enlist domestic help from local women, only too pleased to be earning something again. I found myself compelled to be in my studio, painting without stop, compelled to commit to canvas everything I had seen. The scenes I painted were nightmares that occupied my mind, sleeping or awake. I was obsessed with these images and knew that it was something I had to paint until I could paint no more. Every dead body, every walking skeleton, the chimneys, the pleading eyes, all of it, all had to inhabit my canvas, to bear witness forever. Day followed day for me in a blur that turned into weeks and months as this series of paintings flowed from my brush as if painted by someone who had control over my body. Eventually, the weather started to turn and old habits took over. I found myself continuing my work in the rose garden, where I'd always found solace painting since I was a boy. It was one day, whilst I was painting, one of those terrible camp scenes that I felt a presence behind me. I was nervous, but there was nothing I could do to defend myself against the intruder. I slowly turned to face the stranger. As I did so, he spoke. I don't think it will sell very well this Christmas, Arnie. It was Helmut, my old friend had returned to life. He was gaunt and dressed in rags, but it was Helmut. Through the dirt and his beard, you could still recognize him. He was smiling and as happy as me. He rushed over and hugged me, and we both wept unashamedly. We pulled back after a while and looked at one another. I looked for you. I tried so hard, but no one knew where you'd got to. You're okay, I asked. Eventually, I learned to bend with the wind, old friend. It was a tough lesson. It's wonderful to see you, Heine. That bastard Ratweller, he told me you were killed in the bombing. Since when did you believe a single word that the rat said? I heard about Catherine in town, I'm sorry. You'd grown to love her, yes? Yes, I replied simply. It was the truth. I had grown to care for her very deeply, not in some passionate way, but with a caring and tender emotion that can be just as compelling and perhaps longer lasting. Yes, I loved her, but now she's gone. I'm alone with you, my old friend, just like the old days, two boys together. It'll be great. I said it, but neither of us felt like those innocent boys any longer. What about Marlene and your boys? Where are they? She's helping the boys grow up in the only place where this poison won't touch them, and the men they'll become. He didn't ask me any more about this for the moment, waiting for me to continue my explanation. As I nodded towards the painting, how could we ever explain any of this to them? How do you feel about Marlene now? He recognized my silence as his excuse to change the subject. Well, time's a great healer, so they say. Fancy a drink? I asked, and he smiled his assent, and we walked back to the house. I could drink the entire Rhine if it was made with whiskey and beer. Over the next hours, we tested our drinking capacity to the limit. Eventually, we were amiably chatting the kind of semi-inebriated nonsense reserved for such times. "You know, to be honest, you don't look too bad considering what you've been through. What camps were you in?" "I was in a transit camp, or was it a prisoner of war camp, and then a denazification thing. And then I was here." "I don't bloody know, do I?" "What do you mean? That lying bastard Ratweller said you were in the cellar of the building when it went bang. Said you were buried there. Said you had to be dead. Lying little rat. How comes God doesn't kill the little shit and do the world a favour? If there's a bloody God, how does he let that rat get away with what he's done? Let's have another drink. Fuck the little shit rat. He'll get his. Eventually the world moves in mysterious ways, and it all gets levelled out, and he'll get his." "Do you think so? Do you really think so?" I asked. And that was the last thing I remember of our drunken reunion.